a Jedi.
So then, are you a Sith?
The Sith became far too obsessed with trying to outwit each other. It resulted in them completely neglecting their destiny. And so they are now extinct.
Are you saying you're not a Sith?
Let's not speak with our mouths. But with our blades.
Run, get away, Dan.
Welcome to KonKon's Cantina. Grab a drink, sit back, and relax.
What is up, everybody? It is your boy, it's KonKon. Back at it.
We back.
Again. What the? What was that?
Swallowing my Truly.
Oh, you know. Oh, you're mixing the two?
Yeah.
Ooh. Speaking of mixed drinks, my gosh, have I got a...
That's an embarrassing story.
It's a story that I'm not going to like talking about, but what is up, everybody? It is your boy, it's KonKon. Back, KonKon's Cantina, the 107th episode. Of the KonKon's Cantina. It is a special episode. We are the number one drinking Star Wars podcast in the galaxy. Mm-hmm. If you didn't know.
Now on TikTok.
Now you do. Now on TikTok.
We did it. Finally.
We're doing it, Peter.
Finally.
We've talked about it for a very extended period of time. Yes, we are on TikTok. KonKon's Cantina podcast. On TikTok, post some of the Galaxy's Edge stuff that we've gotten.
It's done very well.
Yeah.
Anything with us talking in it? Not so much.
Not so much. People don't care when they listen to us about it, but they love seeing me swing around a lightsaber. So
I think they like the stormtroopers and Rey. Come on, let's be real.
I like Rey too. Yeah. I don't, you know, it is what it is.
She's no Padme, but
that person that you were hearing, the Bionic Man himself,
yes,
also known as
co-founder of http://www.helium.web.co/konkonscantina.com. I am now an entrepreneur. I'm doing my part.
Full send.
Supporting the Russians and Chinese.
Yeah.
And they're building their infrastructure to take over the world with my new helium miner.
Listen, they're going to spy on us, so we're just giving them the network. You know, it's nothing personal. We're helium miners now. It is what it is.
So rich in like just 2 months. I can feel it.
Listen, it's going to happen. Shout out to Shib, by the way.
Shiba's to the moon right
to
now.
To the moon. Let's keep it going. Let's 600% keep that
train. Increase since we bought in. Let's keep it going.
Let's go. and sitting to my left, the returning guest.
The casual kid, aka Jordan.
I was gonna interrupt and go, aka Jordan, the mayor of Mos Pelgo, if you didn't know. Guys, this week, of course, this episode is sponsored by our Patreons over on patreon.com/KonKon's Cantina. We appreciate every single one of you.
Oh yes.
Everything that comes from Patreon we use to put back into the show. We are about to move back into the studio because the weather here
is subsiding.
It is subsiding, so we can go back into the studio, which that some Patreon that money helped with that.
Yep, built the studio for us.
Now, we might be able to afford to actually insulate the garage.
Insulate it and put a little split.
Yeah, we do. We got to get an AC. We got to get something in there. But, guys, the agenda of this episode, we'll be talking about Star Wars Visions, Episode 7, the intro. Of course, we will be doing the recap, and that is pretty much where we'll be ending it. We were supposed to do the Boba Fett thing, and I kind of forgot. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, let's talk about the trailer.
I guess, yeah, because it's
going to... Trailer dropped.
Yeah, trailer
this
dropped.
This week.
Or we can last... talk about it. We can,
we'll talk about it
after, and we'll just push that out.
Okay, yeah, let's do that.
We'll do that. So we'll come back to the Boba Fett talk. Once again, the agenda, of course, we'll be talking about
never again.
Guys, of course, real quick, housekeeping, all the social medias. Once again, TikTok, TikTok has done amazing things for people.
Follow us.
Yeah.
Comment, share it.
Yes, that it would be super awesome. Hopefully, we'll be getting more content there. Also, of course, Instagram, all the normal stuff, KonKon's Cantina, Facebook, all the stuff you guys already know. And we are a Cantina podcast, so we're going to go into the Cantina right now.
Welcome to KonKon's Cantina. What are you having? But remember, no droids.
I'm going to get my embarrassing story out of the way really quick.
Okay. I was going to say, I was going to go first so I could set you up for your story.
Should I even... I didn't even bring the bottle. That's how mad I am.
I'm going to go first because it sets up your story.
Yeah.
So I'm drinking a... Konnor had a lovely bottle of
Don't bring it up.
Long Branch, Wild Turkey Long Branch on his shelf. That was one of his gifts by a podcast listener, actually, that gave him that bottle of Long Branch.
Yes.
And I have been hearing a good thing to do with Long Branch is mix it with Wild Turkey 101 50-50.
Mm-hmm.
Because Long Branch has a very smooth taste, but it's missing some of the bite. It's missing some of the higher percentage that I look for.
Mm-hmm.
So... this is a 50-50 mix of Long Branch and 101. I have not tried it yet. This is live on the podcast airs.
I tried mine.
Okay. That is really freaking good.
Yeah?
Long Branch is really good.
Long Branch definitely has a lot more flavor, and the 101 definitely has some bite to it.
Yeah, it gives it the bite. This is really, really good. I would give this an easy 8.
Really?
The only thing that I would need to think about is... price point, because you got to have two different bottles to make it. I mean, I guess it would go twice as far.
It makes a lot of drinks. Yeah, yeah.
You're mixing it 50-50, so it's not like you're going to have a whole bunch of one left over.
Mine's actually a 9 out of 10, because I have a little bit of something extra in mine.
What was your drink supposed to be?
So my drink was supposed to be Oban Reserve Single Malt Scotch, the Night's Watch edition from the Game of Thrones. If you don't know... last week, I also had a Game of Thrones scotch. I had the whole collection when GOT was super hype. Got it from ABC Liquor. Have finally opened all the bottles. I've killed a couple. Still have a couple left. You can now get a lot of them for cheaper than they were originally.
Oh, but cool. You poured the last half finger worth of
the Oban to try today. To put this in perspective, I don't think that it's worth the price point that I paid for it.
Okay.
But the price point now is 100% worth
What'd
it.
What'd you pay?
When I bought the bottle, it's the most expensive bottle in the set, and it was $279.99.
Ooh,
that leaves the credit card warm when you're putting it away.
I didn't pay that. So the way that I actually got my Game of Thrones set of scotch and whiskey or scotch is I actually commented on a raffle for on ABC's Instagram.
Okay,
and I got picked. And so I was able to purchase the whole set for $500.
What?
So I got the whole set for $500 because I won.
And how many bottles? That was at least, 10 bottles, 12 bottles?
It's 8 bottles.
Okay. That's great. So you're paying $60 a bottle, roughly.
Yeah, yeah. So it's still...
That's a great deal.
It's still worth it. But for the Mando score for that Oban, which... okay, to the story. I poured you some. I poured myself some. Mm-hmm. You drank yours. I went to drink mine. Yep. I got our glasses mixed
Delicious,
up.
Delicious, smooth, stupid, silky, good. Great flavor profile.
Oh, and we're talking about the Oban. The stupid Oban, good. Yeah. 9 out of 10 on the Oban,
easy,
for sure.
Easy.
The best scotch I've ever had, and I'm not a big scotch person. Then I went to mix your drink, which was the
50-50.
The 50-50. I accidentally poured it in mine. We're talking I ruined a $25 pour.
Yeah.
Seriously.
It splashed, and you splashed the 101 onto it. Not even the little bit nicer Long Branch.
Yeah. It really is not that bad because it just tastes like Wild Turkey up front, but then it has
the scotch flavors.
It has a scotch on the back end. Okay. Yeah, it's really not that bad. No rating for this. I was being sarcastic, but anyway. Jordan, what are you drinking?
I found this over at Total Wine, and I had to buy it. It's the Super Marzen Bros.
You got to show that. Hold that up to the camera.
Florida Ave Brewing. I saw it. I'm I'm a nerd. I'm a video game nerd, so I absolutely had to buy it. Actually, technically bought this for my wife because she asked for it.
Yeah. But. So if you're not watching the video, it looks like a classic Oktoberfest vibe to it, but then it's 8-bit Super Mario.
Yes, exactly. Kind of
like the two things meshed perfectly into a can art.
I have not tried this yet. I have no idea. So let's give this a try.
I think it's gonna be good. You can't go wrong with the Marzen. It's one of my favorite styles of German beer.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, it has a lot of really great flavor. It's a classic Marzen. Mm-hmm. Like you can't go wrong with it. Yeah, I'm gonna give this a solid 7.
I like the can how they added. There's a lot of stuff going on with the mm-hmm. can. We have a hop. We have Lederhosen, which just looks like Mario's pants.
Yeah.
Like, but they're not black suspenders. They're brown.
Yeah.
And then we have a pretzel. We have the hat. My hat is vastly superior than yours, of course.
Of course.
Your hat would actually help you fly with the raccoon tail. Yeah,
but yeah, I'd give
this... Mario music. It's copyrighted. No big deal.
I'd give this a solid 7. It's a really good beer. I could destroy.
Where did you say you found it?
Total Wine.
Okay.
It sells in a 4-pack. That's the only thing.
Total Wine, I feel, has been getting... Their craft beer section is really expensive.
Yeah.
Mm. Like, I know, like, everything's going up, but it's been really expensive. Like, the last time I went into Total Wine was to pick up those Warhead beers, mm-hmm. and even the Artisan Warhead beers, those things were, like, $5 a piece. Yeah. I was paying $21 plus tax for a 4-pack.
It's getting expensive, and also, Total Wine, I've noticed, is they're reducing their beer stock too, which really sucks.
Yeah, but they used to have a whole wall almost, mm-hmm. and now it's like two little shelves.
It's an aisle, a full aisle, and one wall. And dude, that's
ABC
it.
Did the same thing.
A Total Wine? Mm-hmm. There's more than that.
Not the one here.
Well,
in
of craft beer. Oh, you can get the bigger packs in the back and, you know, bigger cases. But
yeah.
it's compared to what it was, where there was two solid aisles of beer. Now it's really just one, and then the side one. It's shrunk and it's noticeable, but maybe they're going for quality instead of
quantity. I think craft beer is kind of taking a slide in lieu of people going to local breweries and not buying stuff that's distributed quite as much. I've kind of noticed that in the last couple years.
I've definitely bought less because of how many breweries are.
Yeah, so many local breweries that you'd rather support local.
Yeah, I'd rather go to Toll Road than go to Total Wine and be disappointed.
Kind of the reason the
bought.
World of beers started mm-hmm. slowly dropping off and falling. I think we're seeing it kind of industry wide.
Yeah. What did you give it?
I'd give it a 7.
7? Okay, 7. I remember that. We need to post that one up.
Yep.
Guys, Star Wars Visions, we're coming to a close.
We're on the we're going downhill now. In the last few episodes,
and a lot of people still, I'll find out who I was listening to today, but
I like this episode.
I do like this episode too. It's just we're like one of the. I was listening to Jedi Order today, a Star Wars and pop culture podcast, and they were lumping multiple episodes together.
Uh-huh,
and I've just seen that a lot. Not that there's anything wrong with that, mm-hmm. Whatsoever. It's just. We're covering like
giving each one its own time to dig in. Some episodes that we've done have been 20 something minutes long.
Yeah, and others
because there's not much to say. But some of them we've gone an hour.
Well, that could also just be the industry itself because you know they threw all these episodes out at once.
Mm-hmm.
The faster you can get them out and lump them together, the sooner you get that content out and people looking for it. So I think it's more strategy than it actually is. You know,
I think
going through the content.
I've enjoyed covering it.
Jordan's
episode low-key by episode,
telling
though.
Us that we have the wrong strategy.
Oh, what, I mean. It is what it is.
Hey, you do you.
Yeah. Listen.
Like you're doing it wrong.
It is what it is.
Like, this is literally my job. You're doing it wrong.
This is the best format, though. It really is.
And that's, we wanted to do the format again. Yes. That was the big thing. And it's definitely how we're going to be doing Book of Boba Fett. Which, by the way, my prediction for, this is the one thing I'm going to say about the trailer. If you want to say something too, you can. Everything that we see in that trailer, all episode one. Every bit of it.
That's a good idea.
Yeah.
Every single scene, well, that is all, it's all episode
in
one.
In Mandalorian, I think the trailer only took us to the third chapter of the season. And
Second,
yeah.
Like, it did go to third because we saw the boat. And
yeah, so I think that's a really good estimate. Like, one, maybe two at the most.
Yeah.
Because everything's Tatooine.
I'm sticking to one.
I'm sure that the whole show's not taking place on Tatooine.
I hope for your mental sanity, every episode is on Tatooine and we never leave.
It's like, if I'm going to be pissed that this show's coming out before Mandalorian, you have to be pissed
exactly,
that it's on Tatooine.
Exactly. Yes. That is sincerely what I am hoping.
That's good friends do.
Yeah. Guys, all right. How did you feel about the animation style of The Elder? Finally getting into the recap. Me and you talked about this.
Yeah,
I really, really, really liked the
thought
animation.
It was crisp, clean. Mm-hmm. To me, it looked like somebody drew the whole episode on Procreate. It's mm-hmm. just reminding me of that art style that you can do on Procreate, which not a bad thing.
Yeah.
It looked good. I liked it.
You got studio knowledge?
There wasn't much really to bring up. It was Studio Trigger. Jordan, you raise your hand. You got something
I
interesting.
I have everything you need to know about Studio Trigger.
I read
Trigger.
About it, and it just nothing really piqued
my
interest.
But is it relevant?
Interest.
Relevant, yes.
Okay.
For people who like anime, and even people who only casually, definitely. So Studio,
2011, they came out.
Studio Trigger, same studio that actually made the Twins episode as well.
Okay, so last episode we thought that there was only one studio. I don't know how we missed that. So we have another that's studio that's done two episodes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So Studio Trigger did that one. They're made up of former Gainax staff, which this is the staff that made Evangelion and Gurren Lagann.
Oh, I love Gurren Lagann.
So the guys who
you need to watch Gurren Lagann.
It sounded like you guys were just like mumble mouthing. I don't know what you said.
Dude, Gurren Lagann is really, yeah. really good.
So the people who made that went and made their own studio, and it's Studio Trigger.
Okay.
They've made stuff as Kill la Kill and Little Witch Academia. They're a smaller company.
Okay, I've heard Kill la Kill too. Yeah.
So they're a smaller company, but yeah, they're the ones who, you know.
Dude, Gurren Lagann is very popular.
Yes.
Very, very popular.
So.
But that's not them.
No, it is.
No.
It is the same. It's the same guys.
Some of the people that were that studio broke off and created this.
Yeah, exactly.
It's so it's not the same studio.
The same.
To give you a little bit even more context, the animator for this studio and who's a co-founder was the one who did the animation for Evangelion. Also, on top of that, the director for this episode directed episodes of Evangelion, the anime Fooly Cooly, Fruits Basket, and of course Gurren Lagann as well, and he's co-owner of the studio too.
Maybe I was the wrong person to read about this because all of that was just went straight over. Well, my head.
Guru was on.
You said something about melons.
Fruits Basket.
Fruit Basket. All right.
It's a very popular anime, according to my wife.
Let's get into this recap, guys. Once again, The Elder. We're in hyperspace. I loved this intro because this has never happened in Star Wars, and ever since the sequels, we actually have a better visual representation of like this wormhole, more Star Trek ish version
of what hyperspace travel actually is,
instead of just the stars
streaking
and then it cuts off whatever. A young Padawan and a Jedi Master discuss how many planets the Master has been to. The Padawan is a little disappointed in the lack of action that he has seen in the Outer Rim. Before they drop out of hyperspace, a disturbance is felt in the Force by the Jedi Master.
Which I quizzed you if you could figure it out.
I still haven't, but you
still haven't figured it out?
I've heard it. I've heard it a million times. Am I going to be...
The English version, it's the second you hear who it is, you're going to be like, oh my God, now that's all I can hear.
Okay.
David Harbour.
Yep.
Yep.
Like...
Yep.
If you don't know who that is, he's from Stranger Things.
Yep.
He's like, he's been
Red Guardian. That's crazy because I feel like even as Red Guardian and when he's in Stranger Things, he yells so much.
And this was very like mic'd up, super hot. And
he was just on it. Dude, I love it. But it's the nuances in like the raspiness
like
his voice.
His cadence and the way he kind of says things.
Yes.
Like the second I saw that's who it was, I'm like, oh my God, how did I not
pick
that out?
It makes sense too because Marvel, Disney, Star Wars, it's all coming together.
He had some like almost solo-esque vibe in the way he was talking. If you listen to it, like, I don't know, like just kind of like the nonchalance of everything. He's like, yeah, well, we should probably figure that out.
Once again,
the worst impression ever.
I told you, and this is just a cop out because it's so obvious. But dude was so Qui-Gon Jinn; it's not even funny.
Yeah,
I mean,
green saber too, which means he's focused on the spiritual as well as the combat side of the Force. So.
The robes. I mean, everything about him to me was Qui-Gon Jinn,
crazy,
like having
big poof ponytail.
Loved it. The most anime thing ever.
Very samurai. Yeah.
You know who he looks like?
Who?
Mitsurugi from Soul Calibur.
Yeah.
He does look like Mitsurugi. It's freaking Mitsurugi. And he has that same, like...
Yeah.
And when I used to play WoW, my human rogue, same exact hairstyle. It was like a top knot, but the top knot was super blown out, and then there was hair that came down.
Yeah.
I love that hairstyle. Very like a Goku Super Saiyan 4, just all that
and
stuff.
And he had like the typical string beard.
Yes,
like,
dude. Yeah. Like, not clean shaven. Everything about his character design, I loved.
I liked
everything.
It. And the kid. the yeah. Padawan as
Dan.
Well. Yeah.
Yeah. Love yeah. Dan too. We were talking, he reminded us of Dominican.
Yeah. And
we were trying to pick like
the actor
we were,
the actor that plays him, uh-huh. he didn't really have anything credited that was worth mentioning. Like no. he did like Alive Grease and mm-hmm. then he was in like
a Alive Grease. Like yeah.
Like, I don't know. I
think like, it was like Broadway?
I think it was a recording of a Grease... I don't know what
it
was.
I think it was like a TV look... broadcast of it.
Oh. Yeah, like, yeah. he had, like, two or three things. Like, he's an up-and-coming guy, but he was yeah, definitely...
Doing Grease is not easy, yeah. so...
He's definitely, like, I would say some type of a mixed ethnicity. Like, I would say maybe...
The actual dark, actor dark or the character?
Dark skin slash Spanish, like, some like a... Like, you said Colombian or...
Dominican.
Dominican, mm-hmm. like... He had that vibe, which you could see. I don't know if they purposely paired the voice actor with the vibe of the
That's
guy.
That's what I was asking. Was it the voice actor?
It matched exactly what you would kind of think, except for the hair was different.
Oh, okay. But he was also like darker, mm-hmm. like olive
yeah,
skinned.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I really enjoyed Dan. And I think the voice acting, I love how we haven't gotten into the episode like at all.
That's fine.
The voice acting is like, this one is also one of the few ones where episode two, English all the way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This episode, English all the way.
Yeah,
I think the voice acting in this one, especially for when we get to the elder, is just way better.
Mm-hmm.
And Dan mm-hmm. sounded super, super whiny in Japanese yeah. when I watched both, and I didn't enjoy that. It was almost it was too much. Yeah. I enjoyed it more in English.
Yeah, in this episode, it's so well written because we're from where you've gotten it, we're only 3 minutes in,
yeah.
but they've already established both characters, their mm-hmm. backgrounds. And their dynamic mm-hmm. together.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, yeah, that was really great impressive. Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Quick stuff, too. This is one of the shorter episodes. Dan, the young Padawan, is ready to fight. He feels the threat. He says, "Do you think it could be Sith?" The planet that the two are visiting is Hobo. That's not right.
It's Habo.
Habo. Hey, that's because I wrote Ho. I told you that I did that. We were watching it before, and I was like, dang it, I spelled Habo wrong. I wrote it as Hobo. And
the planet we are visiting
it's
is
Hobo.
On the back of a train with Hoboken. A stick with all of its clothes wrapped up in an old sheet.
Hoboken, New Jersey.
Hoboken, New Jersey.
Dan comments on the beauty of the planet. This is one thing I appreciate about Dan, too, because Dan has two sarcastic comments, and it continues
very
throughout
dry.
Very dry sarcasm. He talked about how he loves being his master's apprentice, and then he was like, I was being sarcastic. And then flying into the planet, we get this similar Force Awakens, Rey and Solo, where she's like, I've never seen so much green. And he's like, oh, I love the planet. But then when you get down there, he's like, oh, it's even more beautiful, but it's all overcast.
It's like gray,
nasty,
overcast, nasty.
Yeah. Super nasty.
It looks even better down here.
Dan comments on the beauty of the planet once again. The people of Habo are very, very shy. After speaking with some of the locals, the master has discovered that an old man has landed on the planet just a few days ago and then went to the mountains. This was an old man.
An elder of another tribe, I think.
Yeah. That's what they were saying. Mm-hmm. Which, when he said, like, he landed, I'm like, okay, so he landed. He has a ship. So why do they just like assume that he's from another tribe? Is this like how closed off the people are?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think that's exactly
like
what
he's
it
from
was.
Another planet. He has to be.
They made a point that they don't get many visitors ever. Like they never mm-hmm. get visitors. So somebody coming by and saying, yeah, I'm elder from another tribe, they wouldn't know a difference.
Yeah, you could have showed up in full on stormtrooper armor and they would say, hey, look at this weird tribe we've never seen.
Yeah,
that was kind of the vibe I was mm-hmm. getting.
I told Justin this whole segment right here of this episode gave me real Sanctuary vibes from Mandalorian
with the kids and
with all the little kids with Dan and the krill farmers and then you made this comment super anime with like the winking and the little kids, the head stacked on top of each other.
It's like anime trope of like communication without words. That's what they can do so well in anime.
Yeah.
Oh yeah,
exactly. Back to the recap. This elder might be the one that the Jedi Master sensed. If that is the case, this is a dark force user that is masking his presence. Also, this was a super cool touch for the Jedi Master to bring up because we talked a little bit about when we think this time period was, and because of mm-hmm. how crazy the idea of Sith being around, we were like, oh, this is definitely prequel
era. Yeah, the robes, the lightsaber mm-hmm. hilts that the two Jedi had.
Yes.
And then Sith have been gone for hundreds of years. You mm-hmm. kind of get that vibe.
I was,
you would know, Ki-Adi-Mundi. The Sith have been extinct for over a millennia.
This magic hat that's like squooshing my my giant forehead down.
I initially thought that this was actually High Republic era with the Sith being
gone. The robes weren't right for High Republic. No. They're all fancy, gilded.
Yeah, they weren't lavish enough.
Ah, okay. Yeah. All right.
But once again, same thing. Sith gone, High Republic robes.
They got that drip.
Yeah. they got some cool stuff with the High Republic
robes.
That's
what the kids say, right?
Yeah, that's it.
Right, you got it.
Shaka Souffle.
Nailed it.
If that is the case, once again, this dark side user is masking his presence. Very similar to how we know that Palpatine does in the prequels, once again, bringing more to that tie. Dan suggests splitting up to cover more ground and finding the Elder. His master led to lead with the ship if in case he comes back, and Dan to scale the mountain to find the Elder himself.
Immediately knew that was a wrong decision. Like, never split up.
Never split up. Don't do that. They've never seen Scooby-Doo.
Yeah.
I mean, clearly. Vamga lurk this planet, which is just a large predatory creature.
Yeah.
Which I don't know if you've ever seen... You know what? It's not as similar as I thought it was, so scratch that. I'm not even going to bring it up. Led by local children, Dan goes up the mountain. The master finds the starship and immediately calls Dan. Why? It resembles the old Sith ships as seen in Holovids.
Very ominous black. Almost like a mixture of a Lambda shuttle and a TIE fighter kind of merged together the way it had the curved side wings, but they also folded up.
Shout outs to the Sith for being like... we're trying to hide. We can't let anybody know that we're here.
Make everything black with red accents.
Paint it black and red. Just like goes to the paint shop. Was it the meme like where the
Oh, say no more, fam.
Yeah. Or
the exhibit meme.
Yeah, the exhibit meme. And then there's also the you naughty. What's the you know what I'm talking about? No? Okay, anyway, there's a TikTok
where
it's
like... This
is
the point of the show where we just do TikToks and memes.
Yes, exactly. Yes, this is the meme version. Okay. So he finds the ship and he recognizes that it is Sith. Dan finds the fallen Vagma, which has been killed by a lightsaber. And I really liked this point where they bring up that it's obvious that it was a clean cut and it had been killed by a lightsaber.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminded me of this scene from Revenge of the Sith.
I was like, I hear something. It's like, what is that?
Killed not by clones. This Padawan. By a lightsaber he was.
So it's just like more tying into canon of the obvious
tell
of,
by the strike and the wound.
Yeah. The Jedi's obviously are masters of the lightsaber,
thing with lightsabers is when it slices through something, it also immediately cauterizes the wound so you don't bleed. It's just like a clean strike that's immediately cauterized, so there's no blood.
Except for Ballface in A New Hope.
Yeah.
When his bloody arm is all over the ground.
They were figuring stuff out.
Yeah, they didn't know yet. Yeah, you know.
It is also an anime trope that anytime before you meet the villain, you kind of see what their power could be. And what you're getting yourself into.
Nani?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So having them do that ahead of time, that was really cool.
Yeah, he went plus ultra.
Yeah, he does. As he turns around in the very scene that you heard opening this episode, Dan is met with the Elder.
Uh-oh.
His master urges Dan to get out of there. And as he turns around, he sees the black cloaked figure and meets his gaze.
I love how tiny he was.
Dude. Like, and I love how his robe doesn't go to the ground.
It's like he sees little ankles.
It's like Schmeagle. It's like Schmeagle, like with a cloak.
Gives it to me.
Yeah, exactly. The Elder does not claim to be a Sith, but he does activate two red bladed lightsabers
and the yellowest of yellow
straight Sith eyes
and the yellowest of yellow teeth.
Yeah,
bro,
when you are going through Sith training, him and Darth Maul toothbrushes were just none. No toothbrushes at all.
God, get the Marlboros out of there. Like, come on, guys.
Nothing at all.
And speaking of the Elder and great voice acting this episode,
dude, yes,
James Hong.
Yes.
Who's been in everything.
Literally everything.
Oh, name some stuff.
So everything. He's been acting since 1955.
There you go.
And he's been he was David Lopan in Big Trouble in Little China.
Racist.
Mr. Ping from Kung Fu Panda.
Racist.
The blind.
Wait, that's the little. That's the little master guy.
Yeah, exactly. Oh,
okay. Yeah.
Also, Wong, the blind man from Balls of Fury.
Oh my God, I need to watch Balls of Fury.
I know. I just realized. That is a forgotten movie.
Yes,
that is like. Okay.
Why have we not watched Balls of Fury?
Together. It is a underrated. It's a ridiculous movie, but it is underrated. It is underrated. That'll just send us down a spiral where we both buy ping pong tables, and it's our goal to become.
I'm already building one in my backyard.
Welcome to KonKon's Cantina, the Star Wars ping pong podcast.
I'm getting rid of our
are you gonna build the concrete one?
Yeah, I'm building.
Wait, why are you getting rid of the pool?
Because it started leaking, and I don't feel like messing with it anymore. So I'm gonna build a concrete ping pong table.
Well, there we go.
Rip.
You heard it here first. Back to the recap.
Local update on Justin's back there.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, guys. The obvious Sith moves quickly against Dan. The Sith also figures out that Dan, because of his power level...
One strike, he's like, nah.
Yeah, he's like, oh, you're not the one I was looking... No, that's... No, that, I thought it went way better in my head.
That went straight Smeagol.
Yeah, it did. Oh, I
was like Smeagol and Scooby-Doo combined.
Yes, exactly. Ruh-roh. He figures out that he's obviously the Padawan and not the Master, not the strong one that he has felt in the Force. And I think that this is something to note, too, because he kind of comments on his degraded power level over the time.
Because of his age.
But think of it like, at whatever point in time that's never clarified that this takes place, Sidious would have 100% been able to be like, know who you are. This guy couldn't differentiate between the two.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe at one time he could. And I didn't write down the quote, but at the end of the episode, the quote that the Master gives about how power...
Yeah, it's almost like a life lesson.
Yeah.
Once again, very Qui-Gon Jinn-esque stuff from him. But the Sith, I love how quickly he moves against him. Like, the prequel era, from what we saw, almost seemed very formal, where everyone kind of like meets. And we do kind of have that show off where we activate the lightsabers. But then it was just like, and he like...
Gone.
He just goes straight for him.
So fast.
And it's cool, too, because I also didn't write this down, but I looked up... you know how like Donatello has the two?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. There are also short katanas that samurais would use, mm-hmm. and that fighting style.
Shoto. Shoto is always a short bladed katana.
There's a fighting style with two Shotos, and that's what this was. And the jabbing motion was literally historically correct, which like blew my mind.
Yeah.
Did either of you ever watch the show on Discovery Channel called Weapons Masters?
Mm-mm.
I've watched so many of... I don't know if I watched that one, but I watched all those Discovery Channel weapon...
Quick,
and human weapon breakdowns and all those
detour.
Things.
Quick detour. Weapon Masters was a thing where they took martial arts people, gave them historical weapons, and they showed how like deadly they were. Just that kind of stuff. And the katana, obviously, has always been just reprised as the best sword ever, right?
Right.
And this is now the second episode, and where the next episode we're going to have is going to be the third. We have three katana-style lightsabers, four if we include the darksaber.
Don't forget Ronin's episode two.
One.
Well, I guess, I mean, it's a katana hilt, but not a flat blade. Yeah. Not a flat,
I was talking more the actual...
The blade
itself, because so we have the girl, we have F... She has one. We have, I'm going to include these as one, not two, but we have this. And then in our next episode, we're going to see another katana style lightsaber, all derived clearly from the darksaber, which just fits this anime trope, for lack of a better term.
Which it also obliterates people's arguments about, like, I don't like anime in my Star Wars. Like, no, like, this is not anime only. Like, the darksaber exists, and it has existed, and has a full lore behind it.
And
this
Jedi
isn't like a new thing that they made up and just threw into here.
And the Jedi literally acknowledge when it's in Clone Wars, when they're talking about how the darksaber came about from Clan Vizsla, the first Mandalorian to become a Jedi. They literally express the fact that they don't know anything about the darksaber. Like, they don't know how it was created. And I really want more canon to
dive into that.
I do, but at the same time, I don't, because I like not knowing. But
I kind of like how the episode a few episodes ago with the Ninth Jedi where they had the Sabersmith and mm-hmm. he created the tempered crystals.
Yeah.
But I like the idea of in The Mandalorian we had the Armorer. In mm-hmm. that episode we had the Sabersmith.
Yeah.
Like somebody who is ultra specialized in maybe his connection to the Force is with some type of has a connection to, this is in the actual Ronin book that I'm reading right now, mm-hmm. but he actually has a connection to electrical and droids and ships, and he can see mm-hmm. where there's something wrong with stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And in the Ronin book, he's that's what his thing is. The Ronin is actually the guy who created these saber accessories, like the girl had with the umbrella.
Yes.
He created all of those. Because that's his connection to the Force.
Yeah.
So I love this idea.
So they literally had a connection. Spoiler warnings for the Ronin book, by the way.
Well, it's not a spoiler warning for anything that matters.
Yeah.
But it's cool to think about if somebody had this special Force connection and they were able to build the Darksaber with the flat, colorless blade. I'd love to see something that dives into it.
Yeah.
It would be so cool.
Yeah. No, it's super cool, and I just really... I appreciate where, they keep saying that this isn't canon, right? This isn't canon. And I understand why they're saying this isn't canon. But honestly, even if this stuff was canon, it wouldn't change anything.
No.
The sequel trilogy changes.
Some of these would. Not what? Every what? Individual.
Give me an example.
Not every individual episode, but some of them would.
Give me an example.
I don't want to give you an example.
Give me an example.
Because it's the one that's I've been reading, and it's very different.
But is that in the book?
Everything in the book has gone into detail of why things like that are in the episode, and then you're like, oh, this is definitely alternate universe.
So I guess it doesn't matter, because I don't know if you're of the same camp as me. I think you are.
Mm-hmm. I like camping.
The canon, non-canon thing really does not have an impact on me.
No, if I know something's a one-off story,
Exactly. If I like it, I like it.
Yeah.
So I guess it doesn't matter in hindsight, and I'm going to be honest, I kind of forgot where... all this was going, how did we even get...
We're talking about the lightsabers.
Darksabers. Anyway.
I digress.
We majorly digress.
I'm just over here sitting when we get back to the
episode. Yeah, we get back to the episode. I enjoyed seeing the same style of Katana lightsaber blade.
The unstable version, at the bottom, he didn't have a hilt guard necessarily. No. It was just flickering because it was unstable.
Dan, when he ignites his lightsaber... 1000% Last Jedi when Rey activates the Graflex. It is my favorite lightsaber font on all of my NeoPixels. It is my favorite lightsaber activation scene in all of the Star Wars when she is standing there in Last Jedi and she's about to do her training. Mm-hmm. And you have the little Rey theme. Yeah. And she goes, just the way that is the exact same. Prove me wrong. It is the same sound.
And I definitely believe it.
I love it. It's the blue saber. It
Too bad he gets wrecked.
Yeah, he does. So back to it. The Sith just immediately just starts poking holes in Dan's mm-hmm. defenses. He moves against him quickly with slashes, pokes, and prods, and eventually cuts down Dan. As the Jedi Master is running up the mountain, unfortunately, once again, he senses that his Jedi... Padawan is in danger. Yeah. At this point, I thought he was dead.
I did too. It looked like a straight slash through his gut.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's
gut
done.
Wounds are done.
Yeah. Of course, the Jedi Master quickly gets up to the mountain and encounters the Sith and starts fighting him. Swiftly, after they clash and slash with their lightsabers.
He looked carelessly.
Yes.
Was not even bothered
very,
by
very
the Sith.
Very, very calm.
Yeah.
And he literally does the Qui-Gon Jinn.
Mm-hmm.
The Sentinel style, activate. Yep. Yeah. I should know what lightsaber form that is off the top of my head, but it is escaping me at the moment. Swiftly, however, the Jedi Knight disarms the Sith. He does this quick little maneuver, grabs him by the wrist, takes his lightsaber.
I like how delayed the chop of the saber is.
Yeah. He's just like,
so disrespectful.
He just sits there and he's like, what is he doing? can't do that. Dang it. Yeah, he just throws it up, cuts it in half. He does nothing.
Then he goes full toddler rage tantrum.
Lightning crazy. Enraged by the disarming and the destruction of his lightsaber, the Sith sends a full flurry of Force lightning. And I love that this to me, this goes back to the Jedi Master talking about the holovids, mm-hmm. because he goes, this power. Like, he immediately recognizes it. He doesn't know what it is, mm-hmm. but he knows what it is probably because of what he's been taught.
Yeah, and, like, the ship he identified not from what he saw in person, but what from he learned exactly. in the holovids.
Mm-hmm. And this, truly is, you know, you think of, like, once again, I really think this is prequel era. And you think of how many people on the Jedi Council sincerely had never encountered a Sith, like, ever.
Right.
Yeah.
And for him to have this happen to him, and even, like, you think of, like, Qui-Gon encounters Maul on Tatooine, goes before the Jedi Council, says, I have no doubts what I encountered was a Sith Lord. A Sith Lord? And they're like, no, this isn't possible.
Right.
And he was like, he was trained in the ways of the dark side. Like, and,
wrong, Qui-Gon. He's not a Sith Lord.
Yeah, exactly.
Idiot.
Clearly, he was a Sith Lord. How did you guys feel about the Elder, period? Like, did you like the character design? Do you want to know more? I know I'm kind of skipping ahead to, like, our quest, but, like, obviously, after this, let's just finish the recap, and we'll come back to the Elder. So, to conclude the recap, he disarms him with one lightsaber. We use the Force Lightning. He then, because Dan is not dead, Dan throws his lightsaber, deflecting the clash of the Force Lightning and the lightsaber of his Jedi Master. Give him a distraction. Yellow teeth, yellow eyes, straight up looks at Dan like he's the one that's the threat.
Right.
And we have
the moment I've been waiting for
your entire life. You know what? You say it.
So I have had this giant problem that I'm like, why does nobody, like, take advantage of deactivating and reactivating their lightsabers in duels, in fights, and everything? Mm-hmm. It's like, it seems like it should be second nature or common sense.
More of a thing.
Like, yeah. If you're locked up, boom, deactivate, reactivate it, and you're, like, you're it good. Seems like it should have been something that they do, and I finally got the moment of him doing that.
Yeah.
Yep.
Best, like, it was such great so satisfaction cool. for me. I'm
you know
like,
you've seen it before, though.
Where? Is this animated?
Nope. This is canon.
I don't know if I believe you. I do believe you, but...
Yeah, you know you believe me. Unfortunately for us... In the throne room duel of...
I don't acknowledge those as...
In the throne room duel they are in The Last Jedi...
They are less canon than Visions.
She is locked...
Got him!
Rey is locked up, and she deactivates, drops it, and then...
Yes, I do.
Yeah, remember. Yeah. She does.
So we've seen it before, but... It's
not the same, what's the, like, what's of what the, I was
is it a Stella?
About.
A Stella blade.
It's oh, a stiletto?
A stiletto. Yeah. Thank you.
Stella's a beer.
Yeah. I've always just like, well, why don't we just like kind of like how Cassian in the beginning of Rogue One, like uh-huh. he walks up behind that guy and he's like, hey, it's okay, and he just yeah. shoots him. It's kind of like just, hey, it's fine.
And just, yeah.
It's like, that's it. You're done. You get out of here. Clean yourself up.
I was glad to finally get my moment of deactivating in the middle of a lockup yes. and then reactivating
right through the heart.
Yeah.
Loved the poster-worthy shot is the Elder looking off in the distance, mm-hmm. and he's, like, full lunged forward, and the saber is going through him out of his back. I would love that shot. That'd
yeah.
be cool.
On yeah, that would be cool.
Desktop background, it'd be super cool. The Elder, the Sith, whatever you want to call him, he is defeated. Before his last breath, though, he pulls out a remote, and he blows up his ship, which... More drama to the episode, I guess.
It could have been some secret there.
Yeah.
Something, yeah.
Something we'll never know the importance of without continuing the story, mm-hmm. which we'll get to later.
The Jedi at this point conclude that no doubt the Elder was once a powerful Sith, and this is based yep. on what he had told Dan.
Oh, yeah, we kind of glossed over that, how he said he left the Sith Order because they were self-destructive, basically.
Yeah.
It's Bane.
Yeah.
It's Bane's speech. Mm-hmm. And Bane didn't exactly have a group of followers, but if you haven't read the Bane trilogy, it is
another thing.
A tier Star Wars,
not canon, but it doesn't freaking matter.
Only
because
a matter of time, my friend. I'm
serious. I do believe that it will become canon again.
Well,
but
the whole nother thing, but yeah,
Plagueis is canon.
No, it's not.
Plagueis
is, but the book.
So that is something that wasn't, yeah. and then they brought in. So, like, if they did Plagueis,
wait, what?
Like, Plagueis is canon again.
The book.
Well, not the book that was written, but, like, the character.
He never wasn't canon. He's mentioned in Revenge of the Sith.
I know, But I'm saying, like, they said that nothing that was written before
Was Plagueis... Oh, I might be wrong. Is Plagueis... Plagueis wasn't written before Revenge of the Sith came out.
Yes, it was.
There's no way. Revenge of the Sith came out in 2003, dude. There's no way.
Maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, you're wrong.
I can't remember.
Digress.
But anyway,
right now.
What I'm saying is, like, they're bringing non-screen about characters back. Like, Revan is like a more recent
example.
Exactly.
That 100%.
I can't imagine. Like, Bane is so good. First of all, there's nothing contradicting in the story. He's not overly. What they didn't like about Canon was like Grandmaster Luke that was like superpowered.
You said Canon. What's
EU?
EU.
Extended.
Yeah.
Expanded. Extended universe.
Yeah.
But anyway. Bane is perfect.
Yes.
Bane, Xana, everything about that story, like
Darth Xana, second to my heart, as opposed to Natalie Portman. Padme Amidala. Yes. It's Padme and then it's Xana.
Like,
Darth
Xana. The Elder was monologuing Bane for lack of
100.
Better
words. That was my overall point is he was bringing up the rule of two, basically, and he saw what the Sith were doing. The Sith just kept destroying themselves, and you know. So overall episode, let's talk about the characters. Do we want to see them again? Would we want this story to continue? Does anybody want to go first?
I will.
Go ahead.
So from the beginning of this episode, and probably the reason why I wanted to be on the episode to watch this is because it reminded me so much of the anime Rurouni Kenshin.
Yes.
It reminded me of that also, this episode, and Rurouni was also the first episode, the duel.
Yeah, Rice-a-Roni. It gave me such vibes because, you know, that show also has the same, you know, master-student relationship. It has a monster of the week, which is always some either unknown person or an old man who is this deadly master, and he has to
defeat
him.
Huge thing with 90s anime period.
Right.
And I love that.
Yeah, and so it gave me that vibe, and it made me want to watch more. The relationship that the master and the Padawan have, I want to see more of that. I want to see more of this story because in such a short episode, they covered a ton of stuff.
Yeah.
They did great set and world and character building for this.
And on top of that, the animation is so simple that you could make this into, you know, a 24-season episode or a 24-episode season or something like that. So I loved it. I loved the story. I loved the animation. I think this is one I would definitely want to watch more of.
I 100% agree. I loved how eager Dan was, remind Anakin vibes, you know, over eager, seeking violence, all that type of thing. We have the pulling in. It's like the Anakin Qui-Gon relationship that everybody wanted to see that we never got, you know. And the Jedi Master, which you said he was named.
Yeah, he's named in the credits.
He is. In the credits.
Yeah, he's named in the
credits. Because in the episode, it just says Master the whole time, but the master himself,
he had
absolutely
a super Japanese name.
Absolutely loved his character,
Tajin Crosser.
Wow, yes, that is Master Crosser.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Master Crosser, super loved the character, loved the design, the voice acting, 10 out of 10.
Oh yeah,
seriously, need him to do more.
Some of the voice, I will say, I think the individual voice acting was great. Some of the moments felt very much, though, that they recorded in two separate studios at two separate times and not a conversation.
Yeah.
I had a few moments where I felt a little disconnected, not because the actor, like, was annoying to listen to or wasn't doing well, but it just didn't sound like they were conversating.
Who are you?
What?
Who are you? Who are you? Who are you?
I don't know.
I don't either.
Is this a bit?
No, it's not. Like, at the beginning of the episode, you were like, I love it.
It is.
And now here we come at the end, and you're like, listen, I hated it.
No. I'm saying that's, like, the only thing that, like, there was a, not the whole episode, some of the more back and forth between
I think the master
and the Padawan, it felt like they were definitely recorded at two separate times.
Do you think that's because of how nonchalant David is?
It could be.
That's where I get it.
I felt like he was reading lines and not responding to what the other person said in some instances.
I
so,
can see that.
We made a joke last episode about me liking Frozen, right? Mm-hmm. And I seriously...
That's not a joke.
It's not a joke. It's not. I seriously like Frozen 2. And it's funny because I'd never seen so much detail in animation and how much goes into voice acting and all that. There's a documentary on... Docutary. No, that was... Yeah, Docutary.
Wow. Yeah.
I was stuck between the joke of we kept saying docutary instead of documentary, and I combined...
Documentary?
Yeah, documentary.
Not docutary.
Listen, that's the joke, and it tripped me up. Anyway, there's a...
I'm dying.
There is a thing on Disney Plus where they show the making of Frozen 2.
Dementia-tary.
But they have everybody in the room... recording together, like you're saying.
Yeah.
Instead of being in separate sound booths or one person being in one sound booth reading their lines, hey, get out, we got one sound booth, you get in for the docutary. But you get what I'm saying. And they had all the voice actors at certain parts of the movie together because you couldn't hit those lines.
You can't play off of what the person says.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that was my whole point. So I get what you're saying.
It's a nitpick. It's not like I didn't enjoy it because of this. Yeah. I definitely want the story to continue. I would like to see more. I think this is the first one in a few episodes. Well, I guess only since the Ninth Jedi. But like this is the Toby can go kick rocks. I don't care if we ever see him again.
Who?
Toby?
He can, dude can
don't
dude
care
can me, crash in the Skyhopper.
He's like Mega Man Light Toby. Yeah, I don't care.
Get the hell out of here.
But this is another episode I would love to see.
Yes.
And I was like the third time I've referenced it, but because the Ronin book is the first thing that we actually got to get that mm-hmm. was an extension of one of these visions, I would love to see in some fashion, whether it's a novel, whether it's a comic, like a manga. Like,
no comics.
What if they did an original manga of one of these?
They have too much money. They have too much time. They have too many resources. I am tired of key stories being...
I wouldn't call it a key story, though.
This isn't. Freaking Vader's whole thing. Now we have Crimson Dawn thing coming out. Mm-hmm. And now there's a whole rumor of Darth Maul getting his own spinoff. Spoiler alert, it's probably going to be another freaking comic. Stop making comics.
I don't dislike that idea. I like comics.
No, bro, I have never...
enjoyed comic books.
I have never seen you with a comic in your hand.
What
ever.
Are you talking about? Never. I literally bought books of comics on our last vacation together.
Where?
To North Carolina, and you're reading my Canon comics as I was reading them.
That's different. That's a graphic novel.
It's not.
It's a graphic novel.
It's a comic. It's a trade paperback of individual issues.
My point is there are too many very, very good Star Wars stories that are coming out in just tiny little 100-page books. When we get Bad Batch Season 1, and you're telling me that you want this story to continue in a comic?
I do.
Dude,
I am going to disagree that I love comic books. I always have. Mm. I think the heroes and superheroes that you love were created by comic books.
Cool. I'm not talking about them.
I think that this would be a better option. Like, if it is a comic, I'd be fine with it. Uh-huh. If it was a manga, I'd be fine with it. Uh-huh. A better option would be feeding one of these studios that does not have anything on its plate.
Yes.
Like... Disney.
Make us a 10-episode season.
So something to keep in mind, they recently announced that Disney is going to start making anime specifically. Hmm. They already have a couple of projects in the pipeline.
How dare you insult comics.
Now, something I want you guys to go back, and I hope you guys can remember this. Do you remember when Nickelodeon or Cartoon Network...
Yes, I remember them.
...would do special blocks where they would... basically just put pilots out there.
Yeah. Are you talking about like the Tartovsky Clone Wars was a 5-minute per...
You know what else was? What? Invader Zim.
Yeah, Invader Zim.
Invader Zim was a pilot that became popular. Yep. And then they made a season out of it.
I'm wondering if Visions is that for Disney,
what
for
takes
anime.
Off?
And we've said that, like, I think that... Well, Ronin kind of got his own book, so I don't know how much more we'd get of it.
Probably not, but...
My point wasn't that... My point overall is not a hate towards comics. Disney has...
You want
just,
more visual media.
Yes, I want more visual media. And obviously we're getting that in live action form, but...
I'm in agreement with you. If you're going to make an anime that's going to be an anime episode of something, You know, why would you make it a comic book or a manga? I want it to continue in this same medium.
Format.
We haven't gotten anything since Rebels was new. Season 7 of Clone Wars was great.
Yes.
Bad Batch was a miss. Resistance is a miss. We haven't gotten, like, a good original. Like, Bad Batch and Resistance were new.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They have both been kind of misses. I would definitely enjoy an animated version of Star Wars that is good.
I am truly hopeful that season 2 of Bad Batch hits with us more. Because
there's plenty of people, a slow build, a slow burn.
There's plenty of people that season 1 of Bad Batch, it hit for them. It didn't hit for us, but we got super sidetracked. I very much want, obviously, I think you can tell by all how passionate we are about. Mm-hmm. I really want this story to continue. I think I told you this one was one that, like, I knew that I liked, but when I watched it more, and now that we've talked about it more. This might be like my third or even like my second favorite out of all nine.
Yeah. I don't know if it sits up to two, but
What's two for you? Ronin's got to be one for you.
Ronin and Ninth Jedi are neck to neck. This I can see definitely being my third. Also, the episode that we're going to talk about next week is one of my favorite. I like this one
better than Ninth Jedi.
Wow.
I do. I like this one better than Ninth Jedi. Ninth Jedi was definitely good, but I like this one. I like the animation. The
possibilities of Ninth Jedi more than the possibilities of this.
You know what? No, I'll give you that one. Okay, so I'd have to decide between the two, but yeah.
it's still upper echelon of what the visions.
No, if they get back to your point, if they do an animation of this and they do it in the style of Rurouni Kenshin, where it's a monster of the week, mm-hmm. villain of the week, while they're doing an overall.
That's what Mandalorian was.
Right. If they do it in that format for this.
That's your with point, these same not characters, mine.
Yeah. I think this could be a great show.
Yeah. I agree really,
100%.
Yeah, I really liked them. They're both really good.
It wouldn't need to be a super deep show. It could just be a fun show.
Yeah, exactly.
By Helium.
Guys, thank you very much for joining us this week on KonKon's Cantina.
I'm so glad we went over Boba Fett.
We did. No, we said we're going to do that.
Okay.
We're going to do that. Anyway. Loved this episode, guys. Don't forget, we are on TikTok, KonKon's Cantina Podcast on TikTok. We are posting Bat 2 content, everything that we're posting up there. Go follow us there, like us, share. It really helps the podcast. I was your boy, it's KonKon. Sydney next to me.
Casual Kid.
And
how dare you introduce me last?
Listen, get with it.
I'm going to draw this out a very long time. It was me, Justin.